I became involved in civil rights, in the civil rights movement here in the United States, but maybe 3 weeks after I arrived in the United States. The person who taught me what, or showed me what I needed to do at work, was an African-American woman. And on the very first day that I was there, around noon, she said, lunchtime is at noon, and you can go. And she told me what restaurants I could go to. And I said, all right, can we go together? And she said, no. And I didn't think too much of it. I'm asking her 11:55, can you go with me to lunch with me? Maybe she has other plans. And I said, well, maybe tomorrow. And she said, no. Well, and I asked her again a couple of days later, and she said, no. And I said, you know, is there something about me that's troubling you? And then please tell me. And she said, no, you know why. And I said, no, I don't know why. And she explained to me that there was no public accommodation law at that time, and that African Americans, or at that time it was called Negroes, cannot go to eat where I can go. And I said, but, you know, Lincoln freed the slaves. And this is 1948, and you can't go to eat where I can go? There's something wrong with it. Isn't somebody doing something about this? And she said, well, yeah, the NAACP and the Urban League. And I said, how do I get in touch with them? And that's how I started working on discrimination.
That case was Gruden versus the Board of Education. Of course, at that time, the schools were racially segregated. The schools, Washington Technical, was for black students, and Rankin and Hadley was for white students. They announced in 1949 that they were going to have a course in airplane mechanics at Hadley. And the Bruden brothers were all excited about the fact, because they were interested in airplanes. And so when they announced that it was going to be at Hadley, they said, well, they wanted to go there. Their father, of course, knew that Hadley was for white students only. But anyway, because they wanted to go, he decided he would go down and find out. Of course, the answer was no. Went to the board, and the answer was no. And then they came to us, the civil rights lawyers. And so we, of course, filed suit in St. Louis Circuit Court, challenging, because they had a course in airplane mechanics at the white high school, but not, and denied them admission, but no course, such course at Washington Technical. The court in St. Louis decided in favor of the plaintiffs, because they could not, the law required that if it was going to be segregated, it had to be equal. So then they appealed to the Supreme Court. We all traveled to Jefferson City, and the case was argued. And the Supreme Court again said, you cannot, St. Louis Board of Education could not have a course in airplane mechanics at Hadley, and denied admission to the black students, and they would have to at least be treated equally. So the Board of Education then closed down the course in airplane mechanics at Hadley.
Core members had many, many discussions. And within our group wondered, just how do we do this? We were doing something new to us. And so far as we knew, new to other people as well. And that was being, in a way, aggressive, but peaceful. How does one do this with an aim such as ending racial discrimination? We wanted our approach to be successful, of course. And in order to do so, we had to have techniques for attracting attention, but at the same time, we did not want to be a police problem. That would be self-defeating, to have or allow or to create any kind of violence. We decided to start out by simply having interracial picnics in Forest Park. And this gave the public, whoever else happened to be in the park, an opportunity to see blacks and whites, African Americans, whites, whatever you want to call an interracial group, to see this interracial group having fun together, picnicking together, drawing horseshoes together, playing baseball together. And we had a number of these picnics in Forest Park just for the sake, really, not only of having fun ourselves because we enjoyed each other's company, but also for the sake of giving people in the park an opportunity to see an interracial group having fun and playing together.
And so we utilized the element of surprise. We set up a picket line in front of the courthouse, the old courthouse, as a diversionary. And then we, Daly and I, we walked on the construction site. Civil rights people at the time pretty much dressed like the construction people, you know, coveralls, Levi's and stuff of that nature. So we walked on the grounds and we walked out. Well, first of all, we did a reconnaissance a week prior to, and then on the day that we set up the picket line and the day we was going to climb it, then we just walked on the grounds. We organized it at lunchtime when everyone was relaxed and doing their lunch. Walked right up to the arch. They had a ladder going up the sides of it. It was about 300 feet up at that point. And we climbed up about 125 feet and remained there. And told them that we were going to remain there until they hired the 100 people. Of course, we had already worked out between ourselves, Daly and I, that I was going to come down because I had to go to work. I was working at McDonald's at the time, so I was working at night, so I had to come down. Knowing that I was going to be arrested, we had the bonds people in place that the moment that I'm arrested, I would be bonded out so I would be able to go to work.
I think you have to look at the progress in cycles. So in the 60s, you had the Civil Rights Act, you had the Voting Rights Act, and you saw an increase in the middle class, not just the white middle class, but the black middle class. And you saw people being able to thrive, send their kids to school, buy a house, all those kinds of things. And I think it's very difficult for people to do that now. You also see, as I said before, a flattened job market. So when I hear young people saying they can't stay in St. Louis because, for a couple of reasons, they always say, one of them is that there's not the kind of jobs here that would keep young creative people here. But the other thing is that it's so sort of stuck in a time warp, and it's so provincial in its thinking and closed-minded that new ideas are just not welcome. And so so there's been this, you know, brain drain of young people that have left over the last 10 years. And I'm saying this because I know them personally, and I did my best to try to keep them here because we need fresh blood. We need to be regenerated and rejuvenated. And if it's the same old people here with the same old thoughts, you'll never see those breaks. But, you know, I think I'm trying to think of some positive change, and that's really a challenge. That's really a challenge.